Welcome back to Your Health Matters. My guest today is Claire Crum, the nurse in cardiac cath lab. Thanks for being on the show, Claire.
You're welcome.
I didn't mean that to sound like you're the nurse. Obviously, I know there's a whole team of nurses.
Yes.
And you're basically 24/7.
Yes.
Our cath lab is covered.
Yes.
You know, we have the team during the day, but then there's folks that are on call, I know.
Yes.
Yeah.
We take call usually a couple nights a week from 7 at night till 7 in the morning, and on the weekends from 7 on Friday till Monday morning. And we are called for heart attack patients, mm-hmm. basically, is the reason at 2 o'clock in the morning when the phone rings.
You know, it's
you're out of bed moving. You don't drop. You don't do anything but get dressed and go into work. And if you're out at the grocery store, you have to drop what you're doing and just come. We have a very limited. There's a national accreditation which we are a part of that requires that we have 90 minutes to from the time the patient gets to the emergency room door until the time we are across their blockage with a wire. We have 90 minutes.
Wow.
So if we are at home and they came into the emergency room, they do the EKG, they make sure that they're on the right diagnosis, the emergency room will call the staffing coordinator and we are just brought right in and we immediately get ready. They bring the patient from the emergency room and it gives the word hustle a whole new meaning.
It
really
bet.
Does. I mean, we are, it's like you're on speed. You're just moving so fast.
Right.
You just can't move fast enough.
Because you've got a life
in your hands. We have a life in our hands, and what we're also doing is we're minimizing the effects on the heart of a heart attack.
Mm-hmm.
Because if a person has a full-blown heart attack that and it's not treated, that part of the heart doesn't work anymore. It dies.
Right.
So they suffer as a result of that long term.
Yeah,
they develop congestive heart failure, and the rest of the heart has to work harder in order to take over for that part that's not working properly. So
timing is critical.
Time is muscle is what we've been saying for years.
Yeah.
We've said that, but now we really are more required to. We have a 30-minute response time for the cath lab staff to be in the hospital. There's rarely a person that's not here within 15 minutes.
Yeah.
We all live close enough that we can be here. In fact, there's one nurse who lives far enough outside town that she and her husband actually bought a house in town.
Right.
And Judy lives in town when she's on call, so that she can respond in a timely fashion.
Right.
Uh-huh. So it's been, as soon as everybody gets here, they're just jamming. They are ready to go.
Right.
They are ready to go.
That's
there's no
awesome.
Time wasted. There are no actions wasted, and the patient is our huge focus.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
you were talking briefly about when you kill that muscle. You know, it's long term and permanent muscle damage that it's done, and that can lead to a lot of other things. Obviously, because if the heart's not strong enough, it's not pumping the blood, which can lead to lung issues. Right? I mean, there's all kinds of side effects that come from that.
Yes. Well, congestive heart failure is the primary result of that, and we can have a person that they even have congestive heart failure, and you look at their vessels, which are okay, and their heart isn't moving very well. And if you can fix the vessels, but you there's not a lot you can do about that. There are some medications that patients can take to strengthen it a little bit, and we also implant pacemakers in patients.
I was just going to ask you about
that. There's one of our pacemakers that the person really has to qualify for this type of pacemaker. It's called a biventricular pacemaker. So both of the bottom chambers are paced, not just the right ventricle.
Hmm.
So, and by doing that, it strengthens the heart somewhat, and it can actually improve
the muscle in the rest of your body, right?
It can improve the quality of life for patients.
Okay.
It really can. They can go from oxygen and not being able to do very much to no oxygen, moving around, functioning at a much higher level.
Wow.
So not everybody has the same results, but it's a wonderful thing for patients to know that they have that option. We implant those here. We implant regular pacemakers, and then their defibrillator. Patients that have a problem with a really strong irregular beat, and I'm not talking about atrial fibrillation.
Right.
Ventricular fibrillation is, if it's left untreated, it will kill you. If it just continues, the person will pass out, and that's the cause many times of a sudden death.
Oh.
So if that has been documented, we can put in an implanted defibrillator. So what it does is there's a wire that goes down into the bottom of the heart, which senses the irregular beat, and if it goes on long enough, it will actually shock the heart from the inside.
So almost like when someone when you talk about
exactly.
the paddles.
It's like the paddles, but it's on the
inside.
And it's a very tiny little jolt, but the patients feel it.
Oh,
and sometimes they'll say they're bothered by it, but they're alive.
Well, I was going to say the outcome's not so good.
They're alive.
Choice. They're, yeah.
Yes, that's the option. So if that weren't there, you probably wouldn't be here.
Right. So.
So that's another wonderful thing that we have to offer. A regular pacemaker. As people get older, many times the certain parts of their heart don't function as they could, mm-hmm. and the electrical functions don't function as they should. So they just require, and it happens over time. We had a 93-year-old lady a few weeks ago, little sweet little thing, and she said she just hadn't been feeling great. And so she decided to go to the doctor. Well, her heart rate was in her 30s,
That's
so
great.
She had a pacemaker, and she said, that's all I felt. A lot of times people will pass out, and she still drives. She's a perky little thing.
Goodness.
I want to be her.
Yeah, you know? Really,
sure. She's great. So,
So
she has a pacemaker, and she said she feels a lot better. I've seen her a couple times since then, and she says she feels great. She's always smiling, you know.
See, so, like we talked about earlier, living in a community like this, you know, you're going to run into those people you care for.
Yes.
So all the more incentive to make sure we do good care.
And we've all realized, too, that age is not a factor anymore. Age is not what it was. I mean, years ago, you'd hear of somebody that was maybe 85 that was having something done, and people would say, that's
my
father.
Yes. Almost,
not anymore. Yeah. Not anymore. There are people that still work at that age.
Right.
This lady, actually, she's a volunteer in this hospital,
cool.
Sure she would be, I won't say her name,
but
she'd be okay with me telling her story.
Yeah, right.
And she's just happy-go-lucky, and she feels better, and
awesome.
So she's, it's gratifying for all of us
to
be a part of that.
Absolutely.
It really is, for every one of us.
To see the difference
sure,
that you make.
Sure.
And that's what I've heard, too, is that when people have the stents put in, the bypass surgeries, things like that, that it's amazing the difference. It's almost immediate because they're getting better blood flow, so their whole body feels better.
Yes.
So that's,
and that leads into cardiac rehab, which is really another vital offering that we have here in our right here in the Wellness Center. And that program, I believe, now is 10 years old. I remember when it started.
Yep.
And it's grown, and there have been a lot of people that benefit from it. And we really try to make sure that the patient knows that this is a very important factor in your recovery, because you have to change things in your lifestyle in order to continue what we've started by fixing this.
Right, you don't want it to happen again.
There are so many factors, the risk factors. I mean, and some patients only have a risk factor of a heart, family history of heart disease.
Right.
The one that's really coming to surface now, the risk factor, is your dental health. Your dental health,
if people
have inflamed gums, the inflammation goes through into your other areas of your body. And I spoke to a dentist last night about this, and she said it is a big deal. And I know it for a fact, but inflammation is part of the heart disease process inside the blood vessels.
Hmm.
So if people have problems with their gums, or they don't care for their teeth, which in today's economy it's difficult for people to go to the dentist all the time, or if they don't have insurance and they have to pay for it themselves. But dental care is really a key factor. Really is. It's very important. Very important.
Heard that mentioned before.
Yep.
That's
floss and brush. Floss
go.
And brush. Take care of your teeth. They're the only ones you're going to ever have.
That's right.
I mean, you can have another kind.
Yeah.
But
well, and like you were talking about with the rehab program too, how, and I've talked before in the show, that it's got to be scary when you've had a heart attack, you're in recovery, but if you had the chest discomfort and those kind of things, and you've got to be scared, how far do I push myself? And I think that's what a rehab program helps. It monitors them very closely, you've got people right there with you, and it helps build both your endurance but your comfort in your being able.
I have thought so many times, if I ever had anything done to my heart, there isn't a way in the world I'd walk around the block without going to cardiac rehab first.
Yeah.
Just because if you did, as you said, if you did have any, just a little twinge or a little inkling of whatever, you would wonder if that's what it was.
Raise it
and
back
you'd
again.
Be afraid. Yeah. I would want to be monitored. And then they increase your activity over time. Many of the people that go through the cardiac rehab program, I'm sure you know, they stay here at the Wellness Center, and they even come on Monday, Wednesday, and Friday when the exercise physiologist and the nurse are here, because they have that comfort with those people.
Knowing find
and they feel a lot safer with them there, and so that it kind of springboards them into doing for themselves. But you know, it's a real it's a strong connection that they have with their patients.
Well, and you were talking earlier about the heart as a muscle that you can strengthen it just like you can the other muscles in your body. And I guess I hadn't ever really thought of that. That when it's healthy, I guess I know that if you keep it healthy by exercise and stuff. But I didn't think of it as you could actually strengthen that muscle if it had started to weaken and build it back up again. So that's a good thing to know.
As long as it's not permanently damaged.
Sure, right.
But you know, that is true. The people that are real athletes, their heart rates are much slower because their hearts are much more efficient. It doesn't have to beat as fast to do its job.
Right.
And so, as opposed to maybe somebody that has a slow heart rate because they have a problem with their heart.
Right. And that's the difference between the two.
Exactly.
Well, Claire, thank you so much for being here today.
Welcome.
And I learn every time I do the show, I learn something myself.
Yeah.
It's always fascinating for me. So thank you again.
Keep taking care of your ticker too.
I will. I'll brush my teeth good too. Thank you all for joining us today. I hope you'll join us again next week for Your Health Matters.